In this video, we are going to see about the interrupts in microprocessor 8085. So what are interrupts? As in general meaning, suppose I am taking class and somebody is entering inside the classroom, then I will be interrupted. The teacher will be interrupted and that person will say for example, he has brought some circular to the students, then he'll read out the circular and once he finishes, he will go. Till that, the teacher will wait till he completes the particular process, the circular reading, etc. Then he will leave. After that, the teacher resumes from where he or she stopped, okay, and continue his teaching. So like way, the microprocessor will listen any external device they want the service of the microprocessor, they will interrupt the microprocessor. The microprocessor listen to the device and provide the service it needed, and then once the service is over, it resume back to wherever it has passed and then continue its execution. This is what interrupts handling in microprocessor. The interrupt IO device, mainly the interrupt takes place between the IO devices, external devices. It's a process of data transfer and it is mainly for transferring of data. So for example, any IO means input transfer or output transfer, etc. So data transfer by an external device or a peripheral can inform the processor that it is ready for communication and it requires the microprocessor attention. The process is initiated. Normally the process will be initiated by the external device. The microprocessor will not initiate. Only the one, say for example, I'm a keyboard. From the keyboard, I am pressing something means the microprocessor will wait for the user to complete his command. Then it starts executing. So whatever the user has typed. So the process is, so microprocessor, the keyboard itself is an external device. When I insert a pen drive, then it listen to that pen drive. When information is coming through the network ports, port itself, network port is an IO device. So it waits for the, when I open a browser and then I press an URL, then the particular information should be taken from the URL through the port. So now the microprocessor listen to that. So all these things are all interrupts. The process is initiated by an external device and is asynchronous, meaning that it can be initiated at any time. Any time it can be disturbed, the microprocessor can be disturbed without reference to the system clock. So the interrupts are classified as broadly two types. Again, it will be classified as two types. One is, the first classification is maskable interrupts and non-maskable. What do you mean by maskable? When I say maskable, it can be prevented from occurring to some extent. Suppose I don't want a particular device to disturb me at this particular time. Okay, that I can do it. That is called maskable. It can be delayed. Or even I don't want that particular external device to disturb the microprocessor itself, that can be rejected. So like a telephone, when somebody calls you, if you don't want to attend, you can just ignore them. No need to, even if they disturb you. That is what, when the call comes, we'll see who is calling. Then if I don't want to attend that, I just leave it. That is what maskable interrupt. But non-maskable interrupts, definitely you have to attend. Okay, you cannot reject it. So like smoke detector, suppose smoke is coming from a house, what everybody will do around those who are around the house, there are neighbors, they immediately attend, because if they don't listen to that, it will catch to their house also. That fire will catch to their house also. So it, then there is a fire, it has to be taken care immediately. So non-maskable interrupts are like that. So for example, when the power goes, cut off, power cut off, then what happens? Immediately our system also shut off. So that is called trap, the immediate interrupt. So it has to be, it will take place. When it comes, it will take place. Nobody can mask it. That is what maskable and non-maskable. Interrupts can also be classified into two types. One is vectored and non-vectored. What is vectored? When a particular interrupt takes place, what it has to do? is already hardwired inside the microprocessor memory. So say for example, there are some five vector interrupts, means all the five vector, if that particular interrupt takes place, what it has to do, everything is already coded inside the microprocessor. Automatically, it will go to that particular place, locations, whatever the instructions mentioned there, that will be executed. That is called vector. Non-vector is the user can build their own interrupts. So the address can be, it is left to the user. The user can design their own service routines for the interrupts. That's called non-vector. An interrupt is considered to be an emergency signal that may be serviced as soon as possible. So any interrupt has to be attended. So what happens when a microprocessor is interrupted? When the microprocessor, it receives an interrupt signal, like a person is standing in the classroom. Now the teacher will listen to that. So now what the teacher is doing, he listened to that and he don't take the class now. That is what. So when the microprocessor receives an interrupt signal, it suspends the currently executing program. So whatever instruction it is executing, that will be only that particular instruction, because it may be in the halfway. So that will be completed and it will be stopped and listen to that interrupt and jumps to an interrupt service routine. So what is interrupt service routine? When an interrupt takes place, what are all the things it has to do for that interrupt? There will be some instruction that is called interrupt service routine, like a subroutine. So subroutine, what we say, for example, when I want to find a factorial, we write a factorial function, and when we call that factorial from the main function, what we'll do? Automatically the control goes to the particular factorial and get executed. The same way, service routine is nothing but another subroutine where if the particular interrupt takes place, say for example, reading of a pen drive, how it has to be read, what are all the devices has to be allocated for that, all those information should be in that service routine. So how the data transfer takes place, that also will be in the service routine. So once it is over, it will return to the main program from where it resumes, the microprocessor resumes. So when the microprocessor receives an interrupt signal, it suspends the currently executing program and jumps to an interrupt service routine, ISR, to respond to the incoming interrupt. Each interrupt will most probably have its own ISR. So after the execution of interrupt service routine, the processor resumes the original program that was under operation before the generation of the interrupt. So once the circular is read, the particular person who is standing on the classroom, outside the classroom, is made to read his circular and completed his job, the teacher resumes wherever he stopped when the particular person comes. So he resumes. That's how the microprocessor also do. So responding to an interrupt may be immediate or delayed. Yes, this is where I say maskable and non-maskable. So maskable, it can be delayed or it can be attended immediately, depending on whether the interrupt is maskable or non-maskable and whether interrupts are being masked or not. There are two ways of redirecting the execution to the ISR, depending on whether the interrupt is vector or non-vector. So while redirecting, where is that particular subroutine it has to find, when it has to, what are the things it has to do when an interrupt takes place? All those things will be present in an ISR. So that ISR may be vectored or non-vectored. So the address of the subroutine is already known to the microprocessor, whereas non-vector, the device will have to supply. The interrupting device has to supply that address, or in coding, the user has to give the address where he has written the subroutine, interrupt routine. So when a device interrupts, it actually wants the microprocessor to give a service, which is equivalent to asking the microprocessor to call a subroutine. It is nothing but a calling to a subroutine only. This subroutine is what we call it as ISR. Then there are two main instructions which helps to the interrupt to take place. What is that? EI, that is enable interrupt, and DA, disable interrupt. Both are 1-byte instructions. And this EI will set the flags, so that set a particular flag so that that particular interrupt will takes place. Same way DI, it will disable the interrupts. So why we need a disable interrupts? So for example, when a particular device is asking for service, immediately the microprocessor listen to it, Okay, so in that case, when some other interrupt takes place, when the microprocessor is servicing that particular interrupts, say for example X interrupt, another interrupt called Y interrupt is disturbing, this will be made as pending interrupt, because that also should not disturb the microprocessor. Once it completes one interrupt only, it will listen to the next interrupt. So in that case, the microprocessor should not be disturbed, but it will be notified about the pending interrupts. That is where disable interrupt works. That is, when a service routine, when a microprocessor is disturbed by the interrupts and it enters into the interrupt routine, it will disable its flags, which is responsible for allowing for the interrupts. So those flags will be reset, which means it will not allow the other interrupts to disturb it till it completes the current interrupts. Once it is over, it will listen to the next interrupt, which we call it as a pending interrupts. The 8085 has a single non-maskable interrupt called trap. The non-maskable interrupts is not affected by the value of the interrupt enable flop. It doesn't care about the trap, doesn't care about the flip-flop, interrupt flip-flops and all. Now, steps in non-vectored interrupts. We'll see what are all the steps that will take place in an interrupt. The interrupt process should be enabled by writing the instruction. So the first instruction, it must be here. If any process wants to interrupt, it must make the EI. The EI instruction should be executed in the main program. This sets the interrupt enable flip-flop. When the microprocessor is executing program, now it checks the INTR line during the execution. INTR is our control line. Okay, it is an interrupt control line. So any device, external device, wants its service, then this INTR line connected to the microprocessor will be raised high. It will be high, given a high voltage. So when that is raised, then the microprocessor will come to know that some device wants its service. So when the INTR is high and the interrupt is enabled by the EI instruction, the microprocessor completes the current instruction, disables the interrupt EI, because now it is going to attend that service. Others should not disturb, other devices should not disturb it for its service. So it makes this DI will be it will execute a DA so that the flip-flop will be disabled. When the flip-flops are disabled, interrupt flip-flops are disabled, no other process can disturb the microprocessor. No other device can disturb the microprocessor. So that is what it is. So once it go inside and do that, it will disable the flip-flop and sends a signal called INTA. INTA is interrupt acknowledge. And it is a low signal. So the processor cannot accept any interrupt request until the interrupt flip-flop is enabled again. The signal INTA is used to insert a restart instruction. So once it is done, now a restart instruction or a call instruction through external hardware. Why this RST instruction? Because it has to go to the particular service routine. Now a device has disturbed. No, for that it has to service that device. What it is asking, what service it is asking, that has to be serviced. So now how it can go that? That is in a memory location, the service routine will be stored. So a call to that particular service routine will take place. This transfer the program control to a specific memory location on page 00H. So, and restart the execution at that memory location after executing the step 5. When the microprocessor receives an RST instruction, it saves the memory address of the next instruction. So whenever there is a call instruction, what happens? After the subroutine is executed, it has to return to the next instruction where it has stopped. So how it remembers? That next instruction address will be pushed into the memory stack. And then only the control goes to the call instruction. Now the program control goes to the call instruction. The task to be performed is written in a subroutine called interrupt service routine. This ISR must include EI. So when it comes out of the ISR, before the return statement, an EI enable flip-flop will be there, so that the flip-flop, the other devices can now interrupt. So this EI instruction to enable the interrupt again. At the end of the subroutine, the RET instruction, it retrieves. So whenever there is an RET statement, the top values will be popped from the stack, which is nothing but the memory location of the next instruction to be executed. So the memory retrieves the memory address where the program was interrupted and continues the execution. So this is how it works. 8085 has non-vector interrupt. These are all the 8 non-vector interrupts, or that is, otherwise we call it as restart instruction. So RST0, RST1, 2, 3, and so on. It is given the name like this, mnemonics, and hex code is, equivalent hex code is this. So if you see this hex code equivalent C, 1100 is for C, and 7077, this is for C, 7. And where this service routine is stored, it is at the memory location 0000H. RST1, it is stored in 008. But if you see this, the difference between this and this one is 8, that is from 0 to 7. Only those memory locations are there. There is 7 to 8 memory locations are there. In 8 memory locations, you can't write a big program which will take care of this RST0. So what it will be, that there will be only a jump instruction, jump to a particular memory location. That instruction only will be in this things. So JMP and some memory locations. So now what the user can do is, they can find out what is the jump instruction given there, what memory locations is given there, and to that memory, like in that memory location, the users can write their own interrupt service routine. So if it is RST0, what it has to do, RST1. The jump instructions are constant. Okay, the memory locations in these things cannot be touched. So we can find out what is the jump locations present here. And in that location, the user can go and write their own service routine.